Hi, my name is Randy Oplinger, and I'm a Sportfish Coordinator for the Utah Division of Wildlife Resources. And today I'm going to talk about two changes in our rules the Division of Wildlife would like to propose during this RAC and Wildlife Board cycle. First, I'm going to be talking about our proposed suite of fishing regulation changes for the 2021 and 2022 fishing guidebooks. And then I'd like to talk about a proposed rule change to our fishing contest rule. So where I'm going to start off is I'm going to talk about our proposed fishing regulation changes for the 2021 and 2022 fishing guidebooks. Now, the process that we followed for coming up with our fishing regulation changes that we're proposing for this series of fishing guidebooks in 2021 and 2022 really follows the process that we followed for our regulation changes and other recent updates of our fishing guidebook. Where we started is we surveyed our fisheries managers for a list of regulation changes that they would like to have considered. When they considered regulation changes, they thought about things that we can do in terms of our regulations that would simplify regulations for our anglers. And they also considered situations where making a regulation change would just make sense from a biological perspective. What we did is we took the regulation changes that they proposed and we compiled them together in an online survey that we sent to anglers in the state to survey their support for each individual regulation change. What we did is we sent the survey out by email to 13,333 randomly selected emails among our pool of licensed angler emails that we have in the state. And we received responses back from 3,038 of those people. That gives us a response rate of 23%, which is pretty in line with the response rate that we typically receive from this fishing regulation survey. Now, one thing I do want to point out is this email pool was stratified in a way that it provides us responses in proportion to the size of each or the population size within each county in here in Utah. And what that does is it provides us a more representative sample and it gives us a snapshot of anglers really from all counties here in Utah. Now, in addition to surveying anglers about their support for each regulation change, we also asked the respondents to provide information about their preferred species, gear type, access method, and water bodies. So we talk about access methods, we're talking primarily by boat, shore, or ice. And when we talk about water bodies, we're comparing stream anglers against lake or reservoir anglers. And what we did is we used the survey data to assess the support for each regulation change at four different levels. I'm going to be presenting those four different levels during my presentation today. So we looked first off support at the statewide level. Then we looked for support within the Division of Wildlife Resources region where that water body resides. Then we looked for support within the county that the water body resides. And then we finally looked at the most affected angler group. And this is typically at the species or gear type level. So I'm talking about species or gear type. Just give you an example of this. If we're looking at regulation change, for example, for kokanee salmon, we looked at specifically kokanee salmon anglers and assessed their support for that regulation change. Okay, so now I'm gonna get into our regulation changes that we're proposing. I'm gonna start with a suite of regulation changes within the Northeast region. I'm gonna talk about two to start with, the Flaming Gorge Reservoir. The first is a bass regulation change that we're proposing. So the current limit for bass at Flaming Gorge Reservoir is 10 fish, and that's a combined total between largemouth and smallmouth. And what we did is we surveyed anglers to assess their support for decreasing that down to a 3-fish limit. We found that 84% of our anglers in the state were supportive of this regulation change, and we found that 66% of our anglers within the northeastern region were supportive, and that 70% of our bass anglers in the state were supportive. Now, one thing I want to point out is in the case of this question, we did not have any indication of support among anglers in Daggett County because we didn't receive enough responses from anglers in that county to actually assess that. So what we're going to recommend is that we reduce our bass limit at Flaming Gorge Reservoir down to 3 fish. And again, that's a combined total between largemouth and smallmouth bass. This regulation change that we're proposing today is really actually part of a collaborative effort between Utah Division of Wildlife Resources and Wyoming Game and Fish. And the two states have been working together in recent years on regulations at Flaming Gorge with the idea of creating more consistent regulations across both states. So the Division of Wildlife Resources is bringing forward this regulation change during this RAC and Wildlife Board cycle, and Wyoming is working on doing the same thing in their state, where they're looking at regulation change where they would actually increase the number of fish that are allowed to be kept from the current catch and release on bass that they have on their side of the lake to the same 3-fish limit that we're proposing in Utah. So if this regulation change is approved by both states, what it'll do is create just one consistent bass regulation across all of Flaming Gorge Reservoir, which makes things really simpler for our anglers because they don't have to track two different regulations depending on which side of the lake that they're fishing on. Now, one thing I do want to point out is if this regulation change is approved here in Utah, it'll become in effect on January 1st of 2021. And then if it's approved in Wyoming, their regulation change cycle is a little bit delayed compared to ours. And we go in effect there on January 1st of 2022. So if this regulation is approved by both states, it would mean that beginning on January 1st, 2022, there would be a common unified bass regulation of three fish across all of Flaming Gorge Reservoir. Okay, so the second regulation change that I'm going to talk about is another Flaming Gorge one, but this one is related to kokanee salmon. So the current limit is a total of four trout, excluding lake trout, with up to three of those being kokanee salmon being allowed within the angler's daily limit. What we did is we surveyed support of anglers for allowing four kokanee salmon within that daily limit. And what we found is this was a widely supported regulation change. And depending on the group that we looked at, either 94 or 95% of our anglers were supportive of this regulation change. So what we're going to recommend is a daily limit of four trout or kokanee salmon. Again, that's a combined total and it excludes lake trout. And then for lake trout, we're going to propose keeping our current daily limit, which is 12 lake trout with one over 28 inches. So that's what we're proposing at Flaming Gorge. Again, this regulation change was done in consort with Wyoming Game and Fish, and they're considering the same regulation change on their side of the reservoir. And if it's approved by both states, what it would mean once again is there would be a common, consistent kokanee salmon regulation across all of Flaming Gorge. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about a bluegill regulation change that we're proposing at Pelican Lake. Pelican Lake was treated with rotenone back in 2018 to remove carp from pelican. And what we've done since then is we've restocked a lot of fish into Pelican Lake, and we've allowed those fish to naturally reproduce and begin repopulating and reestablishing the fishery at Pelican Lake. The good news is Pelican Lake has come a long way since that rotenone treatment, and our bluegill populations, in particular at Pelican Lake, are really starting to come back. Our current limit for bluegill at Pelican Lake is at zero fish, and our statewide limit is 50 fish. And where we sit right now is we think the bluegill numbers have come back enough at Pelican Lake that we could begin allowing anglers to harvest some bluegill at Pelican Lake. But we also feel like the lake hasn't come back enough in terms of their bluegill populations to allow the full 50 fish limit. So what we did is we basically surveyed support among our anglers for three possible regulations that would have the goal of allowing some harvest of bluegill at Pelican Lake, but also would protect the bluegill populations while they rebound so they could fully recover after the rotenone treatment at Pelican. So the three options that we surveyed our anglers over were first off a 10 fish any size regulation. Then we did a 15 fish with only 5 over 7 inch regulation. Then the third option was a 20 fish with 5 over 7 inch regulation. What we found is all three options were widely supported by our anglers, but the one we're going to recommend is the 15 fish with 5 over 7 inch regulation. That one was supported by 72 to 83% of our anglers. The reason we're recommending this regulation change is twofold. First off, this regulation does allow some harvest of bluegill at Pelican Lake. And the second reason is one of our management plan objectives at Pelican Lake is to restore it as a trophy bluegill fishery. And from what we know about the biology of bluegill and studies that have been done throughout the country, one thing that we know is we need to be a little bit protective of the harvest of larger bluegill while that fishery recovers from this rotenone treatment. So we feel of these regulation options that we propose that this regulation, so the 15 fish with 5 over 7 inch regulation, is the one that's most likely to accomplish both those goals. So allowing some harvest of bluegill and also working towards reestablishing a trophy bluegill fishery at Pelican Lake. So that's why we're recommending that option of the three options that we present in anglers. So the next regulation change that we're going to propose is a change in spearfishing at Red Fleet Reservoir. So Red Fleet Reservoir is currently open to spearfishing, and we surveyed support for a seasonal closure for spearfishing for bass at Red Fleet. What we found is we had 75 to 94% support at the state, region, and county level for this regulation change, and we found 27% support among our spear anglers. What we're going to recommend is that we add Red Fleet Reservoir to the list of waters in the state that have a seasonal closure for spearfishing for bass. The reason we're making this recommendation is Red Fleet was treated with rotenone back in 2016, and that fishery is still rebounding from that rotenone treatment. And we know that bass numbers at Red Fleet aren't quite back to where we would like them to be. So we see this regulation proposal that we're bringing forward as a step to reduce the harvest of bass at Red Fleet Reservoir. We know that spear fishers are very effective at harvesting fish, and bass in particular are very vulnerable to harvest during the spawn season. So the seasonal closure is going to help protect bass during the spawn, which is going to help their numbers rebound a little bit more quickly and create really just a more robust, higher quality bass fishery at Red Fleet Reservoir. Our next regulation change proposal is also at Red Fleet Reservoir, but this is for panfish. The current regulation is 50 panfish per species at Red Fleet Reservoir. And we surveyed support for a combined total of 50 panfish with no more than 20 of those being black crappie. What we found is 93% to 97% of our anglers supported this regulation change. And therefore, we're going to recommend a daily limit of 50 panfish. Again, that's a combined total with no more than 20 black crappie at Red Fleet Reservoir. This regulation proposal also stems from the rotenone treatment we did at Red Fleet back in 2016. As we're watching the fishery come back, we're seeing panfish numbers at Red Fleet not quite as high as we'd like them to be. So we see that this proposal helps restrict the harvest of panfish at Red Fleet. That's going to help panfish populations rebound a little bit more quickly at Red Fleet Reservoir. And this is going to be a benefit to our anglers, particularly those who target panfish species. Now, the other thing we're seeing at Red Fleet Reservoir is right now there's a lot of predators at Red Fleet, and it's a little bit limited in terms of the number of forage fish for those predators. So this regulation is going to protect panfish. It's going to help panfish numbers rebound, which is good for anglers who target panfish, but it also should have a side benefit for anglers who target the predator species because those predators are going to rely on these panfish. So in the end, we feel that this regulation change is going to help make Red Fleet more reservoir, just a more consistent and higher quality fishery. So the next regulation I'm going to talk about is another panfish regulation change, but this one is at Starvation Reservoir. The current regulation at Starvation is 50 fish per species, and we surveyed support for a limit of 20 panfish, and that's a combined limit across all species. What we found is that 85 to 94% of our anglers supported this regulation. And what we're going to recommend is that we reduce the panfish limit at Starvation Reservoir down to this combined total of 20 fish. Now, what we're seeing at Starvation Reservoir is, again, panfish numbers are a little bit down at Starvation. And we think that this regulation change is going to help reduce harvest of panfish at Starvation, which is going to help increase their numbers, which, again, is going to benefit our anglers. And also, just like we saw at Red Fleet Reservoir, we're seeing the predator population. In this case, it's going to be walleye at Starvation Reservoir. It's been a little bit down in recent years, and we can attribute that at least partially to panfish numbers being down. So we think that this regulation change is also going to have a side benefit for the walleye fishery at Starvation. So overall, we feel that this regulation change should help improve the quality of the fishery at Starvation Reservoir and also just the overall consistency for our anglers. The next regulation change I'm going to talk about is a change in seasonal closure dates along the West Fork of the Duchesne River. So the West Fork of the Duchesne River is currently has a seasonal closure from January 1st through the second Saturday of July each year. And we surveyed support for adjusting those closure dates to help increase angler access. We found between 90 and 95% support among our groups for this regulation change. So what we're going to recommend is that we change the seasonal closure date to the West Fork of Duchesne to May 15th through 6 a.m. on the second Saturday of July. And what this regulation change does, it helps protect our cutthroat during the spawn season. That's why we have the May 15th through 6 a.m. on the second Saturday closure date. So it helps protect cutthroat and keep their population strong in the West Fork of Duchesne River. But it also opens up angler access during the first part of the year, so about 4.5 months of the year before the cutthroat spawn. So we see this regulation change as something that we can do within the division to provide just additional angler access and additional angling opportunities. Our next regulation change proposal is really identical to the last one, but it's on Wolf Creek. Wolf Creek currently has a seasonal closure from January 1st through the second Saturday of July each year. And again, we surveyed support for adjusting the closure dates to increase angler access. In this case, we found that 88 to 95% of our anglers among our group supported this regulation change. So once again, we're going to recommend changing the seasonal closure dates for Wolf Creek to May 15th through 6 a.m. on the second Saturday of July. And once again, what that's going to do is protect the cutthroat during the cutthroat spawn, but it's also going to open up about 4.5 months of the year where there's additional access for anglers along Wolf Creek. So that was our last regulation proposal in the Northeast region. Now I'm going to shift gears. I'm going to talk about one regulation change that we're proposing in the Central region. And this one is in Red Butte Creek, which flows through Salt Lake County. Currently, Red Butte Creek is closed to fishing. And what we did is we surveyed support for opening a portion of Red Butte Creek to fishing. What we found is we had 93 to 95% support among all our groups for this regulation change. And what we're going to do is we're going to recommend opening Red Butte Creek for fishing downstream of the Red Butte Canyon Research Natural Area. The reason we're making this recommendation is Salt Lake County is the most populated county in Utah, and it also has our largest number of anglers in the state. And quite frankly, there's just not a lot of opportunities for anglers in Salt Lake County, mainly because there's just not a lot of water in the county. So we see this as a way to open up some stream and provide additional angler access within Salt Lake County. So now I'm going to jump to the southeastern region, and we've got regulation change down in the Moab area that we like to propose at Ken's Lake. This is another spearfishing regulation change. Currently, Ken's Lake is open to spearfishing, and we surveyed anglers to assess their support for closing the lake to spearfishing. What we found is that 85% of our anglers statewide were supportive of this regulation change, and we found that 59% of our anglers in the southeastern region were supportive. And we found that 53% of our anglers in San Juan and Grant counties were supportive. And we combined those two counties together because Ken's Lake is technically in San Juan County, but most of the pressure comes from Grant County. So it made a lot of sense to look at both counties and their support for this regulation change. And the 53% is really the average of the two counties, but honestly, the support was pretty similar for both counties for this regulation change. And then finally, we found that 38% of our spear fishers were supportive of this regulation change. So what we're going to recommend is that we remove Ken's Lake from the list of waters where spearfishing is allowed. The reason we're making this recommendation is in recent years, the fish populations at Ken's Lake have experienced some bottlenecks, and they've really fluctuated a lot in recent years, which has made a lot of variation in the angling experience. And as I talked about earlier, spearfishers are very effective at harvesting fish. And we think that this regulation change should help reduce the amount of harvest that goes on at Ken's Lake, which helps stabilize that fishery and help make it really just a higher quality, more consistent fishery for our anglers. So we see this regulation change as one that's really gonna just make Ken's Lake a better place for our anglers to go. And then our final water body specific regulation change that we're gonna propose is in the southern region. And this one's another spearfishing one, but this one's at Fish Lake. Currently, spearfishing is allowed at Fish Lake from the first Saturday in June through September 15th of each year. And what we did is we surveyed support for changing the closure date to coincide with the kokanee closure date of September 10th. This is the statewide kokanee closure date. So we basically surveyed support for removing 5 days off the spearfishing season at Fish Lake. What we found is we had 93 to 100% support at the state, region, and county levels for this regulation change. And we found that 56% of our spearfishers were supportive. So what we're going to recommend is that we allow underwater spearfishing at Fish Lake from the first Saturday in June through September 10th. The reason that we're making this recommendation is right now, if you look at the regulations in our guidebook, it lacks a little bit of clarity on when the spearfishing closure date actually happens at Fish Lake. And that's because this water body specific regulation indicates that it's open through September 15th, but then there's the kokanee closure that begins on September 10th of each year. So we think that this regulation change is just going to provide some clarity on when spearfishing, particularly for kokanee salmon, ends at Fish Lake. And what that does is it helps simplify our regulations, provide us additional clarity for our anglers. Okay, so now I'm going to change gears a little bit, and I'm going to talk about four statewide regulation changes that we'd like to propose. And the first one is a change in our kokanee limit. So right now, if you look at our fishing guidebook, there's actually two statewide limits listed for kokanee. The first one is a limit of four kokanee, and the other one is actually limit for trout, but kokanee salmon are thrown into that, so it's also a second kokanee limit. What this does is it creates some confusion, and some anglers interpret that to mean that anglers are allowed to keep four kokanee plus four trout of some species other than kokanee. So what we're going to recommend is that we eliminate the separate kokanee limit and keep the current four trout limit, which again already includes salmon, grayling, and also various salmonid species or trout species hybrids. We're also going to recommend that we modify the trout limit language to mention the kokanee possession closure date from September 10th through November 30th of each year. And what this recommendation does is it removes that duplicate regulation and really simplifies our regulations, provides anglers just clarity on what the true harvest limit is for kokanee salmon here in Utah. Now, one thing I do want to point out is that we did not survey the public on this regulation change. Where this all started is we were considering an identical regulation change, specifically on Starvation Reservoir and Moon Lake. And when we started looking at our regulations and our guidebook a little bit more, we realized that the same situation applied on other water bodies in the state, for example, Jordanelle Reservoir and Electric Lake. And as a result, we thought that it made a lot of sense to make a single statewide regulation change instead of multiple water body specific regulation changes. Given that, we feel like this is going to be a widely supported regulation among our angling public, and that's just based on the results that we have from Starvation and Moon Lake. We know on a statewide level, looking at when we asked the public about Starvation Moon Lake, that we had 77 to 85% support for this regulation change. And we know that among kokanee anglers, we had 70 to 78% support. So once again, we didn't survey the public about this specific regulation change taken this statewide instead of specific to Starvation and Moon Lake, but we do feel like we have good public support for this regulation change. The next statewide change that I'm going to talk about is related to wiper here in the state. So our current statewide limit for wiper is 6 fish, and we surveyed our anglers to assess their support for decreasing that down to a 3 fish limit. What we found is that 82% of our anglers statewide were supportive of this regulation change. And we looked specifically at our wiper anglers, we found that 70% of them were supportive. So what we're going to recommend is that we reduce the statewide limit for wiper from 6 fish down to 3 fish. The reason that we're making this recommendation is wiper are a sterile hybrid species, which means they cannot reproduce. And that means that all the fish that you ever catch when you're going fishing for wiper were stocked by us. One thing we've been concerned about is over-harvest of wiper, and what that over-harvest does is it reduces the effectiveness of wiper as a biological control agent. So oftentimes we stock wiper to control overabundant prey species like golden shiner, for example, and we see that increased harvest of them at the 6 fish limit creates fluctuations in our wiper populations, and that reduces their ability to control some of those prey species. Also, it creates inconsistencies in our experience for our anglers because of these fluctuations that we see in our wiper populations. So we see reducing our limit from 6 fish down to 3 fish as being a way to stabilize wiper populations in the state, which should benefit them as a biological control agent, and also should provide benefit for our anglers who are targeting wiper here in the state. Now, I just want to throw in a possible kind of side benefit that we've talked about. And that's if we reduce our limit for wiper in the state, what's probably going to happen is we're going to see larger numbers of wiper in some of our fisheries, and that might prompt us to reduce our stocking of wiper in the state. And what that's going to do is free up more wiper that are going to be available for us to stock at other places. So as a side benefit of this regulation change, we might be able to establish additional wiper fisheries here in Utah. The next statewide regulation change I'm going to talk about is related to northern pike. So our current statewide limit for northern pike is 6 fish, and we surveyed support for increasing that to a 20 fish limit. What we found is that 84% of our anglers statewide were supportive of this regulation change. And then we looked specifically among our pike and tiger muskie anglers, we found that 68% of them were supportive. So what we're gonna recommend is that we change our statewide limit on northern pike to 20 fish with one over 36 inches. The reason we're making that recommendation is northern pike are a voracious predator, and they consume large numbers of fish as part of their diet. And what we feel is that increasing the statewide limit for northern pike should help reduce the numbers of pike that we have on the landscape. And what that should do is just reduce the numbers of these native fish and other sport fish that they have or they consume. So this should provide a benefit for our native fishes that often are suppressed by northern pike, because reducing the number of northern pike should reduce the amount of pressure that northern pike put on these native fish. And that should help their numbers rebound a little bit. And then again, broadly, northern pike also consume sport fish. And we've run into some problems managing some of our sport fish populations where we have northern pike just because of the predation that northern pike exert on these fish. And we see that reducing northern pike as being a step that is going to help us stabilize these sport fisheries and create just a better angling experience for the public. Now, one thing I do want to point out is the one fish over 36 inch restriction was something that we added after we surveyed the public. The reason we added that is as we looked at our regulations during the state, we realized that adding this would actually create greater pike regulation consistency and simplify things for anglers here in the state. So it turns out that a statewide northern pike limit change that we're proposing, at least at this time, is going to only affect one water in the state, and that's Redmond Reservoir. Meanwhile, we've got two reservoirs, Uber Reservoir and Recapture Reservoir, that both have a 20 fish with one over 36 inch restriction. So what we realized is if we added the 36 inch restriction to the statewide limit for pike, what it would do is it would create three reservoirs in the state, Redmond, Recapture, and Uba, all with this 20 fish and one over 36 inch restriction. So again, what that does is it simplifies our regulations and creates just more regulation consistency here in the state. And then the last statewide regulation change that I'm gonna talk about is related to the use of bait for catching crayfish. So currently here in Utah, you cannot use bait to catch crayfish in waters where bait use is prohibitive. The problem with this is crayfish are pretty much impossible to catch unless you're using bait. So what we did is we surveyed support among our anglers for allowing the use of bait to catch crayfish in waters where bait is otherwise prohibited. And what we found is we had support among 93% of our anglers in the state for that regulation change. So what we're going to recommend is that we allow the use of bait without a hook to catch crayfish in waters where bait is currently prohibited. And what that's going to do is going to help expand our crayfish harvest opportunities here in the state. Okay, so now I'm going to change gears. So I'm done talking about the fishing regulation proposals that we have for the 2021 and 2022 fishing guidebooks. And I'd like to talk about a different rule change that we'd like to propose. And this is a change to our fishing contest rule, which is R657-58. The reason that we're considering some changes to our fishing contest rule is, quite frankly, our existing contest rule is very complicated. And in a lot of ways, it's unnecessarily prohibited. One reason for this is our current rule creates multiple tiers of fishing tournaments with really a confusing name and designation system for these different tiers of tournaments. And what this really boils down to is tournament organizers have a difficult time interpreting our current rule and trying to determine whether or not their tournament actually needs a certificate of registration. Now, another point of complication of our existing rule is that the rules for tournaments that are targeting warm water fish species happen to be different in a lot of cases than tournaments that are targeting cold water fish species. So a cold water fish species is going to be a trout, a salmon, a grayling, or a whitefish, and a warm water fish species is actually everything else here in the state. And it turns out there's numerous examples within our current fishing contest rule of the differences in how it treats a warm water fish species and a cold water fish species. So I'm just going to highlight two of them. But like I said, there's a handful of them here in the current rule. So the first example is there's differences in the participant and prize value caps for tournaments targeting warm water fish species compared to those that are targeting cold water fish species. And the second example is that contests for cold water fish species are not allowed in waters that have harvest and gear regulations that are more restrictive than the general statewide regulations, whereas contests for warm water fish are allowed on waters that have more restrictive harvest and gear restrictions. So as we look through our current rule, like I mentioned, there's a lot of differences in how it treats tournaments that are targeting cold water and warm water fish species. But what it really boils down to is we look at the data on fishing tournaments in the state and the impact that they have biologically. We find that there's no biological rationale for the restrictions that are currently in place, particularly in cold water fishing tournaments. So that's placing a lot of unnecessary prohibitions on these tournaments and a lot of restrictions that really have an effect on tournaments here in the state. And as a result, it makes a lot of sense to remove a lot of these restrictions because they don't have that biological impact. So as a result of how complex our current rule is, we're going to propose really a streamlined fishing contest rule that removes most of the discrepancies between tournaments that are targeting warm water fish species and those that are targeting cold water fish species. As part of that, we're going to propose establishing a term we're going to call a certified fishing contest that includes tournaments that are targeting warm water fish species, tournaments that are targeting cold water fish species, and tag fish contests. What this does is it removes the complicated tiered system that we have on our current rule and creates really a straightforward system where tournaments either need a certificate of registration or they don't need a certificate of registration. And what we're going to propose, and I'll go over this on the next slide, is really a straightforward set of criteria that tournament organizers can follow, which makes it easy for them to determine whether they fall in the situation where the tournament needs a certificate of registration or it doesn't need a certificate of registration. So what we're going to propose is that a certificate of registration is required if a fishing contest includes any one of the following: 85 or more participants, $2,000 or more in prizes, a live weigh-in, or it's a tagged fish contest. So again, this is a very straightforward set of criteria. It's easy for a tournament organizer to evaluate their tournament and determine whether that tournament needs a certificate of registration or not. Now, once again, a COR under what we're proposing would be required if any one of those criteria are met, and then a COR would not be required if none of those criteria are met. So one benefit of the rule that we're proposing is it removes most of the differences that occur in the current rule between tournaments that are targeting warm water fish species and those that are targeting cold water fish species. Now, one thing I do want to point out, because this is a question that commonly comes up, is there's actually another Division of Wildlife rule. So this is separate from the fishing contest rule that does not allow the release of cold water fish after those fish are possessed by an angler. And that rule does have some implications to this fishing contest rule and does create some differences in how warm water contests and cold water fishing contests occur. But again, they're not related to this rule, they're related to a different rule. So the two main examples of this, so there would be a continued prohibition of high grading during tournaments that are targeting cold water fish species. So high grading is the idea of a tournament angler catching a fish early on in the day and then holding that fish in a live well or perhaps a stringer. And then what they do is they keep fishing through the day, and if they catch a larger, better fish later in the day, they go ahead and release the first fish. Well, in order to keep that first fish until they get that second larger fish that they want to submit for the tournament purposes, they have to possess that fish, and that's not allowed under this other rule. And the other thing that's affected when it comes to tournaments for cold water fish is the live release of cold water fish, if those fish are actually possessed by the angler, is not allowed. So what I just want to point out is that the proposed rule really does remove the differences between warm water and cold water fishing tournaments. But because of other rules, particularly the one related to the possession of fish, there will be some differences that are continued moving forward. Now, the other thing that I would want to talk about is that paper and online fishing tournaments are becoming more common here in the state, and those are the requirements for those contests are not specified under our current rule. So what we'd like to do is basically bring our rule up to the 21st century and address these, because we're seeing these tournaments become more common. Now, paper and online tournaments are effectively catch and release tournaments. So what happens in a paper tournament is an angler catches a fish, they measure that fish, they record it on a piece of paper, and then they immediately put that fish back in the water and release that fish. And at the end of the day, the papers with all the links from fish from all the tournament participants is turned in, and then the assessment is made on who actually won that tournament. Online tournaments are similar, except the fish are submitted online, so the links, or oftentimes there's a picture taken of the fish and the picture is submitted. But what it boils down to is both paper tournaments and online tournaments are effectively the same thing from a biological sense as catch and release fishing. So what we're going to propose is that no CR is required for contests where submitted contest fish are immediately released, and that's going to be regardless of the number of participants or prize values. Because once again, biologically, these paper tournaments and online tournaments where fish are essentially immediately released are effectively acting the same way as catch and release angling for these fish. So what it all boils down to in the end of the day is we feel like the proposed rule change is really a benefit for our anglers, particularly our contest participants here in the state. First off, one reason for this is it treats contests for warm water fish species and cold water fish species a lot more similarly than our current rule. So this simplifies things for our tournament organizers, and it creates a rule that's easier for them to interpret, and also it's just easier for them to figure out where their contest lies and whether or not their contest needs a certificate of registration or doesn't need a certificate of registration. Now, another thing that I'd like to point out is during the RAC and Wildlife Board tour we made last September, we talked about the development of an online fishing contest application portal. We've continued working on that portal, and that's going to become functional beginning of 2021. And really, when you combine the rule change that we're proposing today with the online portal, what it does is it overhauls how we handle fishing contests here in the state. And what it boils down to in the end is it's much more customer friendly. It creates a faster process, a simpler process. And really, the two, the rule change and the online portal, work hand in hand to really provide a better experience and a more streamlined experience for those who are participating and organizing fishing contests here in Utah. So I'd like to thank you for your time today, and I'm going to be participating online during the RAC and Wildlife Board meetings, and I'd be happy to take any questions that you have. Again, thank you.